I am a physical therapist, and I have been diagnosed with EDS as well. So standing up here, not only as a practitioner, I am one of you on top of that. I'm going to start out with a little story about how I ended up in being diagnosed with EDS. And looking back into my childhood days, I go back to little signs like I would drag my feet all the time. And I remember one day in school, somebody came up behind me and said, "Why do you drag your feet all the time?" And you know, after that, I said, okay, I'm going to change my gait. You know, I'm going to start walking and lifting my feet up. But I realized that, you know, I was always off balance. So I kind of went back to dragging my feet away again because of that. The other thing is I do want to let you all know, and I will calm down here with my speech. I have aphasia from a stroke that I had 18 years ago that is kind of a little connected to my EDS when we look back. Now, so some of these things that I'm going to mention, pay attention to, because as I go through my slides of all of this, you're going to go back and say, oh my gosh, it's connected. Wow. So when I was young, I had episodes of my knee, I would say, locking up, or my kneecap kind of subluxating or dislocating, and I would be stuck in a flexed position, and I couldn't get up to go find my mother to tell her I can't move my leg because I couldn't walk. And then over time, it would just relax, and it would pop back into place, and I'd get up and be on my merry way, and you know, until it happened again. Other times, my jaw would lock up. I would just be going to yawn, and I'd get stuck with my mouth wide open. And again, just waiting for that spasm to relax to be able to close my jaw again. And so those were a few things early on. And then my mother decided, I was one of five kids, and of course driving us, you know, all over the world was not going to be an option. So with me falling all the time and having issues, she decided to throw me into the pool, and so everybody else was going to swim as well. So she dropped us all at the pool for swim team, and that's what we did. So come high school, I was a backstroker, and the old backstroke flip turn was a touch the wall on your back and rotate your body around. It's not like the good new one where you flip over and push off on your stomach and then rotate to your back underwater. So I would dislocate, subluxate initially, and then dislocate, which I'm going to speak about that in a little while.
It's just a little while in the back. I was right down, so go ahead. Keep going.
I didn't know it was that loud. And so, you know, that was kind of a key. And they weren't big. They were more subluxations. I'd get the sharp pain, I'd pop back into place, and I'd continue swimming. It would never stop me from the middle of a race. So then, on to college, I switched over to rowing crew. Rowing crew was a nice, safe sport for me as well, because it had me, you know, working in my middle range. The problem was, being in an eight-woman boat, at the end of a race, we had to carry our boat overhead out of the water and back over to, you know, wherever we were, its home was. And so with the fatigue after the race, that's when I realized that those subluxations and the shoulder hypermobility quickly turned into dislocations. So my first dislocation, I was out for about 2 hours. Fell onto the dock in excruciating pain, couldn't breathe. Every time, you know, the dock moved, it was, you know, I can't live like this. Well, when they went to lift me and put me onto a stretcher, they dropped the stretcher, my shoulder popped back into place. So again, they took me to the hospital, did the x-rays, put me in a sling, and I was on my merry way again, back to the, you know, back to the boat, back to rowing again. So the more that happened, the more it would dislocate when I would pick up my school bag, when I would put my purse between the seats of the car. It just started happening more and more frequent over a period of 5 years before I finally had to have surgical intervention. And then another sign I'm going to bring up is I didn't realize I had POTS, but my whole life I would go from sitting down to standing up and feel and black out, literally. My heart would race out of my chest, and here I am, a triathlete, rowing crew, thinking I'm in the best shape possible, but I can't stand up from a chair to standing up. I can't go upstairs. Things as simple as that, where my heart would race out of my chest and I would start going into a tunnel vision. And I'd bend over, you know, take some deep breaths, and then get up and go again. So technically, I wasn't diagnosed until just a few months ago, but I kind of knew I had it the whole time. And finally, you know, have intervention, and I'm feeling much, much better. And I wish I would have done this 30 years ago. But anyway, so that's kind of my story and where we're at. Also, in physical therapy school, massage class, the instructor and the owner of the school came up and picked the skin off of my back in front of the whole class, if anybody knows Stanley Paris, and said, "You must have been obese once in your life." And let me tell you how humiliated I was. And I'm thinking, I have never been obese. Why is he saying something like this? But that, you know, part of that is chalked up to just his personality. But again, these are all signs that now I look back and I'm like, wow, you know, this is all part of EDS. So as PT school went on, we learned differential diagnosis and some other things, and we learned about EDS. And I was like, oh, that's me, I have that. But again, you know, the more that I talked to my local doctor and the more that I talked to anybody, nobody knew about it. So I said, well, why even mention it? Forget about it. So I kind of threw it off my, you know, off my medical radar. And, you know, in the past, I have been lucky enough where I haven't had Chiari. I haven't had, you know, the brain issues or bad spinal issues, but I have had the dislocating joints and have had a bad back, just nothing bad yet. So anyway, as a physical therapist, I feel like looking back now, I spent my entire physical therapy career always looking into, you know, why for me did traditional physical therapy not work? So every time I was hurt, every time I had a musculoskeletal issue, I would go back and have my colleagues work on me. And every time it would set me back and I'd have another problem. So as a physical therapist, I said, well, if this isn't working, I'm going to find what does work. So I set out my whole career to kind of go that route without even realizing that I was going that route. So that's why I'm here now, and that's how I ended up here. So now to my slides, and I am a novice at this. My husband assisted me in writing my PowerPoint as far as just setting it up for me. So bear with me, and we'll get through this, but I hope it's really good information for any of the EDS patients out there who have had physical therapy before, or any of the PTs out there that have worked with patients with hypermobility and EDS. Let's move this forward. Okay, so here's just something to reflect upon. No other disease in the history of modern medicine has been neglected in such a way as Ehlers-Danlos, and I think a lot of you can agree with that. This is a little background on EDS. It was described in 400 BC. That's kind of how old it is. But truly, just in the early 1900s did, you know, it kind of become recognized. And that's from Edward Ehlers and Henry Danlos, who are both dermatologists. And they have come up, you know, let's see, Dr. Ehlers, 1901, recognized it as a distinct entity. And Dr. Danlos suggested skin extensibility and bruising were key factors. Oh, by the way, I had to do a judo class in college. I was bruised from head to toe. Couldn't figure out why I was the only one in the class bruised from head to toe. And again, this is pre-knowing anything about EDS, okay? So anyway, moving on to the Byton. Byton in the 1998 published formal class. I'm gonna go over that. So anyway, that's the classification of EDS, and We'll go over that again a little later. These are pictures of Dr. Ehlers and Dr. Danlos. One's Danish, one's French. Like I said, they're both dermatologists. The EDS definition is heterogeneous group of hereditable connective tissue disorders characterized by three things: articular hypermobility, skin extensibility, and tissue fragility. Okay, so keep that in mind. These are a few statistics out there for hypermobility. This is from a few articles that I pulled, but you can see that it affects women more than it affects men. Also, a lot of these patients, almost all these patients at some point see rheumatology and physical therapy, and you see the higher incidence in Asians, Africans, and Europeans. Okay, joint hypermobility syndrome, knowledge among the USPTs. So this is another article I pulled that was really interesting. It pretty much suggests, I want to go to this because I want to read the results of this. The results of this study suggest that many PTs in the United States are not familiar with the diagnostic criteria, prevalence, or clinical presentation of EDS-3 or joint hypermobility syndrome. And you can also see that a lot of the PTs didn't even realize that multiple organs were affected with this syndrome. There's another study I do want to mention. I did not do a slide for, but it's called Physiotherapy Management of Joint Hypermobility Syndrome, a focus group study of patient and health professional perspectives, which was very interesting. Pretty much two key points I want to make there. One is regarding the physical therapist, it's very important that you have continuity of care. So same PT, or if you have to have somebody cover, maybe two PTs. But you have to develop that relationship with your EDS patient. That is very, very important because you have to know what their daily life function-wise is from day to day. You also have to have a very well, a PT that knows a lot about joint hypermobility and how to deal with it. The other thing is you have to provide reassurance and encouragement to this patient, and that's really developed through that relationship with your patient. Then from the physical therapy perspective, as the physical therapist, you want to have flexibility in the treatment, okay? Your content, your techniques, your mode of delivery, your number of sessions. You also want your patient leading the treatment, believe it or not. You really want to listen to your patient. Your patient is going to tell you exactly what's wrong with them and really what to do. So from there, you want to meet the individual goals to manage rather than cure the patient. So it's all about management, not curing these patients, because you're not going to take away that hypermobility. What you're trying to do is teach them long-term techniques to be able to be functional in life, okay? You want to recognize treating multiple joints at a time and not one single problem joint. So by treating multiple joints, what you're doing is you're working on the body mechanics, you know, in general, so that you're setting up good body mechanics, good alignment for that joint that is so problematic. Because if you don't go back and you don't fix, you know, the alignment of the body, that joint is never going to be fixed no matter how much you work on that one joint in PT. And then the last thing is just maintaining a physical therapy maintenance program, especially for chronic conditions. When you have acute conditions, you just have to be careful with that, because a lot of times when you're treating just the acute condition, you're taking away that whole body hypermobility. So again, you've got to treat those multiple joints to be able to improve that acute joint that's causing all the problems. And so here, you have your joint symptoms, and then you have your other symptoms that are involved in joint hypermobility syndrome. So joint symptoms, you know, you've got your laxity, and we know most of these, your recurrent dislocations, your musculoskeletal pain, etc. Your other symptoms are more in this list, your skin sagging, your hernias, anxiety and panic disorders. That's another thing. I have read in the past, and I haven't read any specific research on this because I'd be researching all day, but there, and somebody else brought it up, I think, on the website about autism being connected to hypermobility, Ehlers-Danlos. So I haven't read anything specific on that, but I did read in my research that with anxiety and panic disorders, it impacts negatively on social function, and autism is, you know, a social dysfunction. So there's a lot that goes into that, and I know a little bit about that because I have a child who's on the autism spectrum. So just connecting the dots with all of this is very interesting. Under those other symptoms are things like fatigue, headaches, delayed motor control, you know, with your children, your chronic pain, more so with your adults, and your sleep disturbances. Okay. These are a few pictures of the first one, the hypermobility, and that's one of the tests on the Batten scale or the Brighton scale. The bottom one to the left, let's see here, is the skin extensibility. Up there, all the bruising, and here just the scar formation that's abnormal. Okay. Next thing is, it even occurs in dogs. they can have that tissue extensibility as well. So, and then the next thing pretty much is, I'm just gonna talk a little bit about the history here. So with the Bighton Hypermobility Scale, first of all, when we're looking at diagnosing whether or not it's EDS, hypermobility 3, there is no genetic test or other biological marker for EDS-3, where there are for the vascular type and other types, but not for the hypermobile type. So it makes it more difficult to be diagnosed. So it takes a long time to be diagnosed. With the Batten scale, this was developed, I think around the mid-1900s is when the Batten scale came about. So, you know, this is your typical test a lot of times that we do to see, you know, whether or not they're hypermobile. But the problem here was that it was identifying joint hypermobility, but it wasn't identifying the symptoms of joint hypermobility. It was just demonstrating actually what's there. So what they had to do is they had to revise it, and actually here, they revised it to the Brighton criteria in 1998. And that was developed to emphasize the systemic and the symptomatic condition. So now it's covering, you know, not only the characteristics that you're seeing in the Batten scale, but now you're covering the systemic portion of it as well. Okay? So you can look this up online, and I did look it up, and it says you're positive if you are have two major criteria, or one major criteria and two minor criteria, or four minor criteria. And there was one other, and I can't remember what it was, but you can look that up and kind of see where you fit, okay? All right, and then I wanted to throw this out there too. I came across in one of my research articles that the simple hypermobility screening tool. So if your patient is not physically there, you want to do a little screening tool to see whether or not they are hypermobile, you can look at this. And it's positive if your two or more of these are present. Okay. Again, back to the point that EDS-3 and joint hypermobility syndrome does affect us systemically. So this is your multi interdisciplinary approach and your team that you would have depending on, you know, what problems you are having, okay? And what's important is your primary care physician is kind of your ringleader, per se. So that person has to communicate with all of these other specialists to really know what's going on, okay? The other thing is the physical therapist also communicates with a lot of the other team members because it does affect, you know, what you do in physical therapy, okay? Especially with dysautonomia, you know, some other issues that you want to be aware of when you're working with a patient with exercise. All right. Goals in physical therapy in EDS, you have your injury prevention, you have your symptom reduction, and then you want to look at physical therapy as a holistic approach, not to cure it, but once again, it's a lifelong management program, okay? I looked at another study, actually back to that original, that first study with the U.S. Physical Therapy Knowledge. The main thing in that study they brought up was, you know, the most important thing was strengthening exercises. The second thing was education about body mechanics and joint protection. Third thing was balance and proprioception training. Fourth thing was pain management. Fifth thing was aerobic conditioning. At the bottom of that list was stretching. Stretching was the least effective with anything that they did in their physical therapy program. There was only 11.9, you know, percent of respondents that had anything to say positive about stretching. Okay, physical therapy approach to EDS. Distinguish whether or not you're having dislocations or subluxations. That's very important because a lot of times when I'm talking to my patient, they'll say, oh, my rib dislocates all the time, or oh, my knee dislocates all the time. But is it really a dislocation or is it subluxating? Subluxation is more common with EDS. Dislocation happens when you have more of a traumatic force, or the force just really, which I'm going to go over, really is overloads that joint traumatically. So your dislocation is a complete separation of the two bones in a given joint, where your subluxation is just a partial separation. Okay. Knowing a little bit more about muscles and ligaments, what they have in common. Muscles and ligaments both are bone to bone. They both have proprioceptors. They both absorb external force. The difference between them are that ligaments are primary stabilizers. Muscles are secondary stabilizers. Muscles are contractile tissue. Ligaments are non-contractile tissue. So what can be changed? What can we do in physical therapy for these patients? We can strengthen the muscles, but we cannot strengthen the ligaments. So what do we work on? Bottom line, we work on the muscles, okay? So it's very important that we work on muscle strength. Okay, the physiology of a hypermobile joint. This is important as well. So start up here. A joint that has not been treated yet may have a muscle spasm. It's very, very common with a hypermobile joint, a weak joint, okay? And so what do we want to do when we have a muscle spasm? Because it's painful. We want to go and get a massage or stretch it, right? Somebody who's normal. But what happens is we get temporary relief. Talked to somebody about that earlier today, tonight. And then shortly after that, we have, again, increased inflammation and pain because that joint is hypermobile and moving all over the place. And then what happens is that spasm kicks back in and that joint stabilization occurs again. So it's that vicious circle that is just going to keep happening if we don't strengthen that joint, okay? A spasm, remember, in the EDS population is a protective mechanism. So PTs, remember that you don't want to take away that spasm until you strengthen that joint. Okay, the importance of exercise here. So as you increase your muscle strength, okay, you're going to in turn decrease your spasm, in turn decrease your pain, and finally increase your function. Okay, and then you're going to keep working, you know, on these things and keep it as a maintenance program. Keep that joint strong. All right. Two type of muscles that we're going to target here that we need to talk about, very important. You have your movers and you have your stabilizers, okay? Your gym muscles, your CrossFit, your body, what's it called, boot camp. That's all your movers. That's your pecs, your six packs, your biceps, lats, erectors, all of those muscles. The stabilizers are your smaller muscles that actually stabilize the joint, and we tend to not do anything with them in a normal gym atmosphere. So in physical therapy, this is something that we really want to work on. We want to work on the rotator cuff for the shoulder. We want to work on the deep hip stabilizers to stabilize the pelvis and the lower part, which is very important, lower part of the pelvis and spine. The multifidi are little muscles that run all the way up your spine, and it's important to strengthen them and to keep them strong because that's what stabilizes a lot of your spine muscle-wise. So research suggests that exercises targeting the stabilizing muscles around hypermobile joints enhance the joint support. Okay, so those little stabilizing muscles, that's what we do in physical therapy, that's what we know well. That's what we need to work on. And I'm not saying only that, you still want to work on your movers, but primarily have to work on those stabilizers. Okay, this is a nice little thing to kind of see what I'm saying, the relevance of muscle strengthening. Strengthening exercises targeting stabilizing muscles around the hypermobile joints may enhance joint support, and this is how that happens. So let's just say your ligaments absorb 10 pounds until failure, okay? Can't do anything about the ligaments, okay? Muscles absorb 10 pounds till failure. This is prior to strengthening that joint, okay? Bottom line is your joint subluxation or dislocation occurs at a total of 20 pounds. That's when that joint fails, okay? Now, with strengthening and after a strengthening program or later on into the strengthening program, again, your ligaments absorb your 10 pounds. That doesn't change till failure. Can't change that. Muscles absorb 20 pounds till failure, so we increased our muscle strength here. So now our external forces up to 30 pounds are tolerated. So now we can tolerate more strength, more function in that joint because we were able to do something about it in PT, okay? I'm throwing it out there real quick. Limitations to strengthening are things like tethered cord, Chiari malformation, cranial instability, GI problems, mast cells, mitochondrial dysfunction, cardiopulmonary problems, and orthopedic problems. And there's probably many other out there that have held some of you back, so you have to figure that out as well with your PT. So you have to guide your PT. Okay, the next thing, improving proprioception. That's very important. Proprioception is the ability to know where your body is in space at all times, where your arm is, where your leg is when you're moving, and that is to keep you balanced. Abnormal proprioception leads to falls. Okay, skin laxity may affect proprioception, so you have to remember that, especially with your classical type, with the skin being so laxed, and there's a lot of proprioceptors in the skin. You have to remember that that has a lot to do with falls as well because, you know, that lax skin is just kind of all over the place. So you have to be careful with that. One of the things I would do is a neoprene brace, or you can do like tight fitting clothing, leggings with a little compression, things like that to kind of pull everything into your center. Okay, coordination and balance exercises may also improve proprioception with physical therapy. That's something we can change. Neuropathways and normal movement patterns are facilitated by hands-on movement assisted by tape and bracing. So a lot of times, if you have a very hypermobile joint as a PT, you can go in there and either brace or assist with taping and bring that joint back into alignment and then follow through with whatever exercise or movement pattern that you're doing. And that's going to bring everything back in and center everything so that your neuropathways are more normalized. And practicing that over time, it will become muscle memory. So that's another way of, you know, being treated for that in physical therapy. Muscle pair co-contractions and rhythmic stabilization. The PTs are familiar with that. There are methods to improve postural stability. Again, what you don't want to do is you don't want to go to end ranges of motion, because at end ranges of motion, again, you're way past, you're overextending that joint and it's going to throw your balance off. So what you want to do is kind of start in a short mid-range and then increase it to a comfortable range, but don't ever go all the way to end range, because if you go past that normal, what we call normal joint movement, you're throwing yourself off balance-wise and setting yourself up for other problems, and we don't need that. So concentrate on that. The ultimate goal is to prevent extreme ranges and abnormal movement patterns to avoid further injury and falls. Treatment of the unstable joint. This is just something that I figured out over time, and now when I go back and I research all of this, and now I look at the other people who are treating EDS, they're kind of doing the same thing, and it's working. We'll go in, and first when the patient comes in, if they've got a problem joint, they've got a problem with that joint and hypermobility, you want to gently align that subluxed joint, kind of put it back into alignment, again through taping or bracing, or just gentle joint mobilizations like Mulligan techniques, muscle energy techniques for the PTs that are out there. You want to align the bones. Line the bones for optimal muscle length, which in turn gives you optimal force and maximal strength. Okay, so that is the importance of aligning the bone. But you never want to do a forceful joint mobilization, because if you do that, you're causing more damage to that weak ligament. That is a problem, and like we said before, we can't change that, we can't strengthen that. The second thing I like to do, and this is controversial, but soft tissue work to relax the muscles, only the muscles that you are currently strengthening or working on can you do that. And that's only to get them through that treatment to be able to get them to successfully perform that exercise correctly. So you can do a little bit of that. So you can do myofascial release, massage, trigger point release. That will decrease the spasms so that you can actually get through that range of motion. But I do caution you with the neck, cervical. I don't like to do anything with the neck, hands on, because the problem is if we take those spasms away, we're jeopardizing, some of the neuro symptoms like headaches and nausea and other things that can, compress the nerves in the cord. So a lot of times what I do is just leave that spasm there and work on strengthening in general, okay? And you have to kind of play with that and figure out what works for that patient, but that's kind of what I've found in my past practice. The third thing is performing strengthening exercises, isometrics, isokinetics, rhythmic stabilization, and closed chain exercises. Closed chain exercises actually kind of put that joint gently, proprioceptive wise, it gives you feedback. So I like, when we say closed chain, it means that your feet or your arm, say if I'm doing a bicep curl, that's an open chain exercise because I'm not on the ground doing something like a push-up. Okay, now I'm controlling with my biceps eccentrically and I'm pushing with my triceps. Okay, so I've got a chain here. I'm connected to the floor, I'm connected to something, versus your biceps. If I can't control my movement and I've got a weight in my hand, I could be doing more damage to that joint you know, with the movement that I'm using. So I prefer closed chain when I'm treating patients as much as I can. Suggested treatment guidelines. Again, these are just my guidelines that work for me. So when I look at a patient, I like to, you know, go over, educate them first, but when I'm treating them, I like to start with the feet. The first thing I always do is look at the feet. What are the feet doing? Because whatever the feet are doing, it's going to throw off everything else if it's not doing what it's supposed to be doing. And what's very common with EDS patients is the pronation of the foot, which I'm going to talk about in a little while. And when that foot pronates, it throws off the mechanics of everything else. So then I like to, from the foot and getting them into the proper shoe wear, the proper support, from there I like to go to the pelvis and the lumbar spine, because that is the key from there. If you can control the core from down here, then you can control everything else in time. So I start with the lower core, then once I successfully strengthen there, then I go to the upper core, neck, thoracic area, then to the legs, proprioception, balance, things like that, and finally functional activities. Okay, so I'm just going to go over briefly, mainly for the PTs. I mean, if you're a patient and you want to look at this and you understand it, that's great. Some of it you will. So when I evaluate the feet and the gait and the shoe wear, you know, keep it simple and make minor changes, because if you make any major changes to their mechanics, they're going to hurt. It has to be done slowly and it has to be done comfortably. So first thing I look at is foot pronation. A lot of times with a hypermobile foot or ankle, you're going to see the talus sublux forward. Okay, this is with the foot pronation. And you're going to have a little pain in the front of that ankle. And you're going to see the talar dome in an x-ray over time, a little worn away, okay, or a lot worn away. And over time, the pain increases. So it's that vicious circle of that hypermobile ankle. And we don't have direct muscles to be able to stabilize specifically. We have a lot of ligaments, but not muscles that can completely control that ankle. So with the treatment, we look at doing an orthotic, some type of orthotic to correct this, to kind of put that talus back into that normal position. Okay, and then if you don't change that, just I'm gonna give you the effects of what will happen is over time, if that EDS person is working with those walking with those flat feet all the time, you're gonna watch the knees go in, and that's called genuvalgus. And when that happens, the tibia, your bone in your shin, the big bone, rotates outward. When that rotates outward, causes your knee pain, okay? So over time again, then what's gonna be affected next? It's gonna go up the chain. So then you're at risk for hip bursitis from there, because now you're changing all of those mechanics over time. Before you know it, why is my hip hurting so bad? Your ankle may not be hurting that bad, but your hip is killing you, because bursas have a lot of pain receptors. So we have to go back and fix from the ground up, per se. And again, you know, treatment with tape, brace, I wouldn't so much worry about strengthening of the knee at that point, because I haven't done the pelvis yet. Okay, I would just look at what mechanically I can change in the feet for their walking and just their everyday movement. So the orthotics, strengthening and controlling the lower extremity alignment for feet. Next thing I do is assess the SI joint and lumbar spine, align the SI joint, which that's a tricky one, address soft tissue, the quadratus piriformis, psoas, they're things that I would work on, and then strengthening exercises, the transverse abdominis and the core muscles. Three main dysfunctions for the PTs in EDS that you're gonna see are your double up slips, your double rotation, your PSIS dysfunction. It's very common. From there, I would move on to assessing the cervical and thoracic spine after I stabilize the pelvis with all those exercises and look at the arms. So from there, I'd look at the posture. Okay, a typical EDS person over time ends up with forward head posture, forward shoulder posture, and kyphosis, okay? I have a picture next to show you. Then I would go cervical spine, make sure you're correcting C1, C2 double rotations again, through muscle energy. I would teach them how to do it themselves, very gentle. And then go to your, and that you have to be concerned of, and I have a lot of this, is the symptoms are dizziness, headaches, and nausea. Whenever I am not in alignment, and whenever my facet joints are locked up, and whenever I'm rotated, and I know exactly when I'm rotated, I will get a little nauseous, I'll get a headache, and I've got to mechanically correct myself and put myself back into alignment. And I've successfully done that for years, so I just do it. Thoracic spine, you want to correct your double rotations, that's common. Ribs, you want to check for your costal transverse joints. Your ribs approximate to the autonomic nerves. So there's your dysautonomia. So if they've got symptoms of dysautonomia, what are the ribs doing? Okay, so you have to look at that. For the women, proper bra fitting, all that pressure over the shoulders and the neck. There's a whole way to look at that, because the way it fits, and whether you're doing a cross back or whether you're coming over the shoulders, depending on, you know, their posture. If their posture is really bad, you've got to assess that completely different than somebody who is younger and in better alignment. So look at that, and then you have to look at your shoulder, elbow, wrist subluxations, and you can adjust those with tape and bracing to align that property. But again, strengthening is the best form to absorb forces. So how heavy is your head? This is always nice to see. So the first guy here is in alignment. The head is about 12 pounds right there. And what's carrying the head? Okay. Now, here's poor alignment. His head is going to weigh 32 pounds because it is way out here in front. And guess where all those muscles have to help stabilize that neck when it's here? Okay, so it's the upper traps, it's the cervical muscles, everything gets flared up. The chest is real tight, the back, you know, is just really loose. So just remember, and I like this saying because somebody else that, right here, posture, structure governs function and function influences structure. So always keep that in mind, okay? That's very, very important. So as posture worsens, the relative weight of your head also increases. Okay, and then you go to assess the lower extremities, move on to the hip and a knee and ankle, you can add in balance and proprioception exercises to increase strength and alignment. And then two slides left, functional exercise and fitness. This is your maintenance program. Your maintenance program can be, you know, improving cardiovascular health, energy and stamina, your low impact exercise, that keeps your flare ups down, keeps your symptoms under control. Aquatic exercise, as long as you can stabilize your core, aquatic exercise is great. It's less stress on the joints. Okay, Tai Chi and Pilates both facilitate balance and control. Bicycling is another exercise that's less joint stress. And it's an aerobic exercise. And then Nordic pole walking, I found that and I like that. I'll have to actually try that. I have not used it with a patient. But that's a functional activity that's closed chain, gives you core stability, and for the PTs out there, it gives you the sling effect and other really good things, coordination-wise and strengthening-wise. So the bottom line that I'm basically telling you is that physical therapy can help. It helps increase strength, increase proprioception and balance, absorb external forces with functional activities, your lift, carry, push, pull. It helps prevent subluxations by knowing where your body is in space and by absorbing external forces. So the last point I want to make is refraining from physical activity due to pain is counterproductive. Inactivity and abnormal movement are the two most important pain triggers. So keep that in mind, because no matter what, if you find a good physical therapist, you are going in the right direction because they can help guide you with all of this. But if you're going to do nothing about it, remember that spasm cycle and that pain cycle just keeps going and going and going, and in turn you get weaker and weaker and weaker. So, and that's it. Thank you. That was my first talk really ever with a PowerPoint, I have a hard time following, but thank you all so much. And you know, any questions, let me know.
Yeah. I have a couple. How about bar exercises? A lot of people are doing bar classes now. I know they are strengthening, but like, do they stretch too much, or how would that be?
Bar does. So, but bar has, the problem that I see with bar is, number one, they have you up on your toes, and they have you way up there and almost point. If you're going to do it, you have to know how to compensate. I'm not saying don't do it. Do it, but do it with compensation, safely, in mid-range. Don't overextend yourself. Don't go to some of the deep stretches and things that they do in the bar. If you enjoy it, you know, work with a PT so that you can modify those exercises and still go to that class if you like it. But just, it has to really be modified. So.
I have two more. Spasms. So we shouldn't stretch for spasms.
No.
What do you
Absolutely
think
not.
Spasms are painful?
Okay, so yeah, and I couldn't talk about everything here because I think I put to sleep half the people here. So things that I use are like just foam rollers. If that doesn't work for you, just the stick rollers. Massage that muscle yourself with something like that so that you can control how much, you know, you can pressure, you can put on that muscle. To me, all that's very painful, so I do it very gentle. Like if I'm dying to stretch, which I am, but every time I stretch, I feel like I dislocate my ankle at nighttime, and I do it in my sleep almost. But so what I do is, you know, I have a stick roller by the bed, so I'll just roll it out. It gives me enough proprioceptive, you know, just neurostimulation for all those muscles to kind of calm down for me to go back to sleep. And I have a couple patients that also I've turned them onto something like that as opposed to stretching because they were having such problems. And they find something, even vibration, you know, like a massager vibrate that muscle, change something up to relax that muscle, not necessarily massage or stretching because you're doing more damage to the ligaments.
One more question. Would band work be considered closed chain?
Yes, if you're holding it from one end to the other, but it's not a good closed chain exercise because it's depending if you have a band that moves, you know, it just doesn't have a lot of tension. Still, you have that lack of control within that range of motion. So just be careful with that. If you use a band, I like to do a lot of isometrics or just mid-range exercises with a good amount of tension in that band. So you don't want to go through full range of motion because again, their range of motion, our range of motion, EDSers, we've got motion that nobody else has, and you certainly don't want to strengthen it in end range and then functionally be doing something and it's strong at that end range because you're going to dislocate or injure yourself. So, okay. Anyone else? Yes.
So how do I find somebody who can help? I mean, I don't live in Charleston area. I live up near Charlotte, so.
I know that's the big question for everybody. Interview your therapist. Develop that rapport with them. There is a book out there by Kevin Muldowney. You know, I've heard good and bad. I like his protocol. It's not exactly what I use, but it's very similar to his. That's a good guideline. It's a nice protocol. And if you're looking for something, you get that book at Amazon. It's called Living Life to the Fullest with EDS or Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome by Kevin Muldowney. And get the book, and then you take that to the therapist because it's written out so that there is an area that says for the therapist, and then the next area for the patient. So it's sectioned off so that you can work together on that. You just have to get somebody that is very interested in wanting to learn with you because there's not a lot of PTs, you know, out there, even based on the research studies, that really, truly understand it. So especially as older ones. The older PTs, you know, way back when, we just didn't get that in school as much as the newer programs are offering. So yeah, do that. And also get on the website and start asking around and see who's in your area as well. You know, because I know there's people around that area. Anybody else?
I guess when you go through insurance, though, they'll say you need a script for PT. And like before I was working on my hip, then I'm like, okay, I guess I'll ask for my back and neck next. Because they won't do the whole body, no matter, even though you have something like that. So you are just treating one at a time. And I can never find a whole protocol from anyone that I would love just to strengthen. I'm always doing one joint.
Yeah.
And I'm ignoring everything else. And I can't spend an hour and a half on one joint. I need something where I can do all the time for everything, and I can't get that.
Wait, that'll change in time. I know that's really frustrating because a lot of insurance will give you...
Can I add a comment?
Oh, sure.
My physical therapist, the way my scripts were written, was for full body coverage for the EDS. And he used to call me a grocery shopping list. I go in and it's, you know, shoulder check, ribs check, back check. So every time I went, because I was on a regimen, as soon as I go in, what do we need to address today? So that's your relationship with your physical therapist, to recognize that they need to know it's over all body, full body, to address what is bothering you that day. And that's how you primary write your script, to cover every joint and not just one.
Really?
And I think that sometimes you have to be careful with the insurance. That is a great point. Sometimes insurances get real funny about that, but what you can do, because you just sparked my memory, what you can do is write for core strengthening. Start with that, and then, you know, 2 months later or whatever, 6 or 8 visits later, when we have to, however often we have to get a new script, you know, through that insurance, then have that your primary care physician write a script for now the upper body, you know, now the thoracic, you know, thoracic, cervical, spine, and shoulder. Yeah, and sometimes I know, and some of the PTs, I don't know, sometimes they'll still say 6 visits. And it just, I think, depends on the insurance. But yeah, start with that and see where you get. And 2, work with your physical therapist. Really encourage your physical therapist to try it. You know, it doesn't hurt to try to have the primary write a script and, like, go, you know, just core stabilization and then go upper core stabilization or cervical treatment, you know, cervical and thoracic treatment, or how, you know, whatever it is that you're working on next. So that's good. Anybody else? So I know we still have Alana speaking here. Long night. All right. Thank you. Thank you all for surviving me.
Good job. Great job, Cindy. Thank you so much. I'm so glad to see everybody. The last I heard, maybe a week ago, there were 7 people registered. So I told the caterer, plan for 20. I apologize that we ran out of water. if you can, make sure you register next time. That's helpful for us to know how many to plan for. That would be awesome. But I know next time I'm going to tell them double water for how many. So we have one more speaker tonight, a wonderful young girl who has had her journey with EDS. And she wants to share her journey with you, and I think I'm going to be so impressed with her. She's a wonderful young lady. We're going to hear about her journey and probably a little bit about her struggles with finding the right physical therapy for her hypermobility as well. So whenever we have a topic, I would love to have a patient speak about their experience, and if we can kind of run in that topic too, if not, just speak about your experience. So I would love to know anytime, contact me through Facebook or my email. If you are interested in speaking, we would love to hear your story. Okay, so Alana, thank you.
So hi, I'm Alana. I'm 18 years old. I'm a student. I'm a senior at School of the Arts. I'm an artist, a photographer, a daughter, and I also have Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, mast cell activation syndrome, and POTS. So basically, I'm the classic Ehlers-Danlos syndrome type 3 story. As a infant, instead of crawling, I rolled around because my joints were too unstable to support crawling. I did ballet for about 10 years, which I think was probably the best thing for me and also the worst thing for me, because everyone saw, wow, she can do that. Let's push her as far as possible. And so I was the girl, you know, hyperextending splits and all that great stuff. But it also strengthened every part of me, which I think prolonged my diagnosis. In about fifth grade, I started having problems with my knees. I went to an orthopedist and he was like, you know what, we'll just put you in a brace and send you on your way, which never do with an EDS patient. That just made everything worse. It inhibited my I couldn't strengthen my muscles anymore. It just made them weaker and weaker and weaker. And I started dislocating, or I started subluxing and dislocated my hip on the other side a few times because I was putting so much pressure on the opposite side. I was having migraines since second grade, which we'll get to the cause of that in a second. But after my knees, we just said, okay, you know, maybe that was a one-time incident, and you know, maybe my stomach problems are just, maybe I have a bit of anxiety and just get nervous and my stomach hurts when that happens, or you know, maybe my migraines were just triggered by the sunlight, all these weird things. And in ninth grade, after I got back from Universal Studios, because you know, roller coasters are great for EDS patients, I had to go to the ER because I was basically paralyzed from the waist up. I just could not move. I was in excruciating pain, and I visited the ER first, and they just gave me a shot of Toradol and sent me home with pain meds. And 2 days later, I'm back in the ER, this time at MUSC. And I spent about a week in that week and a half in the hospital. First, they told me that I had a brain tumor, then spinal meningitis. This is a lot of scary stuff for a freshman to wrap my head around. And then they sent me off to a slew of specialists, neurologists, everyone. And it wasn't until I finally got an appointment with the geneticist about 2 months later that he suggested that EDS might be a possibility. He admitted that he didn't know a lot about it, but could send me home with some literature, and really, that's kind of where it all began. Pretty soon I was diagnosed with posterior orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, which is very prevalent in EDS patients. Not everyone that has EDS has POTS, and not everyone who has POTS has EDS, but it's a very common correlation and very commonly found in a lot of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome type 3 patients. And after that, I started doing more physical therapy, but every single time I went, it was just painful. I would sublux, and I would just go home having a worse migraine than when I came. And it wasn't until I was at a conference very similar to this that lovely Dr. Patel put on, and I met Susan Chalela, that I finally started finding the right people to work with. And I was also introduced to cervical instability. And we had no idea that this was even possible or really prevalent in EDS patients until we went to this conference. And I had made an appointment with Dr. Patel, and we said that it may be a very likely possibility. I went up to have an upright MRI, which is the only way that you can see if you have cervical instability. That's the only way that you can see if your brainstem is impinged, because a MRI where you're laying flat, everything is aligned. It's only when you're standing up that your head falls forward and impinges your brainstem. And sure enough, my brainstem was impinged. And we tried to do everything in our power through physical therapy. And for some, physical therapy works. And I was just too far along where I was too weak, and we had to intervene surgically and stabilize the head by putting a plate on the back and screwing two bars into my C2 and C3 level just to stabilize that so that I wouldn't have any more debilitating migraines, or there are a lot of other symptoms that can occur with cervical instability. But that happened, and EDS patients are known for slow healing. And it obviously isn't common when your surgical wound opens up about a month after your surgery, but we attributed that to slow healing of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome as to why my wound opened up. And I kept coming back to the ER with an open wound. I had to be put on, I had to use an NG tube for nutrition because my throat froze up and I couldn't swallow. They did an endoscopy. It was white and fleshy. I just had so many issues just thrown at me, and I think it was because my body was put into defense mode, because after I think the third or fourth ER visit, when we finally noticed that a screw came loose in my head, that I had actually been battling with staph infection for the past 5 months, that had happened in the incision site. And so we went back and we tried to save the hardware, and it wasn't until October of this year, after many intravenous antibiotics and 3 grams of antibiotics every day, that we finally decided enough was enough, and we finally took out the hardware, because staph infection, although we could clear it out of all the tissue surrounding the instrumentation, the antibiotics can't permeate the actual instrumentation and rid that of infection. And after that, things finally started to calm down, and I have not had to return to the ER since then, which I'm very grateful for. But that also led us to finding out more about mast cell activation syndrome, and I actually got diagnosed with that few weeks ago, which is also prevalent in a lot of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome patients as well. It's where your body is overreactive to higher levels of histamine in various foods, it depends patient to patient as to what you're reactive to, but my body had been sent into defense mode because of the staph infection, and I think that's when my mast cell activation syndrome problems really got amped up a whole nother level. Now I get itchy and I get a rash and I get flushed every single time it's above 85 degrees outside. And that, for another EDS patient, for my mom, it's when it's extremely cold outside that she has symptoms. And so it is different for everyone, but it is just a learning process. Since I was, I'm off my NG tubes, off my TPN, which I was on for a while, hopefully finished with surgeries for now, after 3 surgeries, 2 stabilizations later, I'm back to trying to exercise more. And I noticed as soon as I stopped exercising, I just got weaker, I got more depressed, I was in a lot of pain. And the worst thing, like Susan said, the worst thing is to stop moving. No matter how much pain you're in, you can't stop moving. I'm so thankful to be here today and hopefully give you all a new perspective on the disease and to be able to relate to you guys a little bit more and in the many ways that it can manifest itself. As you all know, EDS is different from each individual patient, and you have to remember that when treating it. No matter what doctor you go and see, no matter what physical therapist you go to, you have to remind them that you are different, you're an individual, and you aren't just like everyone else. EDS is so different. It's invisible too. You have to remind people that this is what it is, this is how I'm feeling, and no, my symptoms are not invalid. What I'm feeling is not. and valid, and you have to find the strength within yourself to communicate that, because ultimately you are the one being treated. You're not treating the doctor is treating you, and that is their job, to listen to you and to treat you. And that's the only way that we can get back to functionality. Thank you.